There we go. Okay. Last week we started talking about electric potential, and it's the potential energy per unit charge. And to calculate a change in electric potential, we use a capital V to stand for electric potential. It's the negative of the integral from some initial point to some final point of E dot dl, where dl is a little unit length. You could call it ds or dr or something like that. But at any rate, that's the way that electric potential changes. And then we had ways to calculate the electric potential for a few things, point charges. Or a point charge. It's just V equals K sub E Q over R. So it looks a lot like the electric field expression, except that it's only got a single R down there on the bottom. And that R is something that would integrate out the other R when you're doing this. So if you have point charges, the electric potential of those, if you have a bunch of them, would be the sum from I equal 1 to n, however many you have, of K sub E, Q sub I over R sub I. And R sub I is the distance from, you'd be calculating this at some point, and R sub I would be the distance from that point to the Q sub I or the ith charge. And this is just a scalar sum, so we don't have to worry about direction or anything. And if you have a continuous charge distribution, continuous, I don't know, I don't feel like spelling today. The electric potential would end up looking like K sub E dQ over R, and you'd be integrating over that continuous charge distribution. So those are ways you can calculate it. The very first example problem I want to do here is one that I didn't get to last Friday or last Thursday, but we'll be using this expression in there. And it's something occasionally handy to use. So don't forget about it. Okay, now suppose an electron is released from rest in a uniform electric field whose strength is 5.9 times 10 to the third volts per meter. And again, that's a new definition of the electric field units. We've been using newtons per coulomb up until now. Turns out a newton per coulomb is equal to a volt per meter. Which is a volt is actually a joule per coulomb. So there's some more review. But through what potential difference will it have passed after moving 1 centimeter? Well, it's an electron in a uniform electric field. And when you have a uniform electric field, and in this case, we'll just suppose that this is the initial location of the electron and this is the final location of the electron, and this is 1 centimeter between these two things. Now, the electron will accelerate opposite the electric field. Remember, the force on a charge is Q times E. That's a vector E. And if the charge is negative, like this little electron here, it's going to have a force in the direction opposite the electric field. So the electric field in this case will point in this direction. And we can figure out the potential difference between these two points. The delta V is going to be minus the integral of E dot dl. Well, in this case, E points that way, DL is going to point that way. And so when we do that dot product, we'd get magnitude of E, magnitude of DL. The magnitude of E is constant, magnitude of DL, and the cosine of 180 degrees, which is negative one. And so what we end up with in this case is actually a minus and a minus, and we'll have the integral from the initial to the final of E DL, but E is constant. And so I could have thought of this as maybe DX or something like that, the total, or actually I'll call it delta X, the total distance that the electron moves. And so we'll get E times the integral from initial to final of DL. This is just the distance, and it'll be delta x in this case. And so we get E delta x. When you have a uniform electric field and you move along the direction of the electric field, the potential difference is just going to be E delta x. And so it's easy enough. And we're going uphill against that. And so there's an increase in electric potential in this case. However, the electron moves in the direction of increasing electric potential because it's got a negative charge. If you had a proton, it would be zipping in the other direction. So, anyway, E delta X in this case for part A. We have 5.9, whoops, E delta X will just equal 5.9 times 10 to the third volts per meter. And I multiply, it's just 1 centimeter, which is 1 times 10 to the minus 2 meters. Meters go away, and I'm going to get 5.9 times 10 to the first, or 59 volts. And this is that thing you have to worry about. We use V to stand for potential, and we use V for volts, which are the units of potential. So just have to be careful. But anyway, that's the potential difference that it moves through. Now, how fast will the electron be moving after it's traveled 1 centimeter? Well, the change in potential energy of that electron, it's actually going to be losing potential energy, but I can write it this way. Actually, this will work. It'll be Q delta V, and Q is minus 1.60 times 10 to the minus 19th coulombs times the 59. A volt is a joule per coulomb, so I'll just write it that way here. And there I have, I'll get a number. I don't actually need that one here yet, but the question asks, how fast will it be moving after it's traveled 1 centimeter? Well, this is a negative change in potential energy for the electron. If we think of the electron as having, well, that loss of potential energy is going to show up as kinetic energy of the electron. And so for part B, I can think our 1/2 mv squared is actually going to, let's see. Yeah, I can do this and just ignore that. Plus, our delta U will equal zero. We can think of this as a conservation of energy problem where the electron has no kinetic energy at the start, but it's got this. Oh, a better way to write this is to think of Ke initial plus U initial is going to equal Ke final plus U final. And let's see. There is no kinetic energy to start with. This is probably a safer way to approach this problem. If I subtract U final from each side, I'll get KE final is going to equal U initial minus U final, which is the negative of U final minus U initial, which is the negative of delta U. Well, delta U is right here. It is negative, but if I take the negative of it, it's positive. And so, get a lot of this stuff before, but that's okay. All of these are processes. In this case, I can say that the kinetic energy final, 1/2 m v final squared, will equal, instead of writing negative delta U, I'm going to write it as Q delta V, but just take the absolute value of that. And actually, when I, yeah, the absolute value, I'll just use the charge on the electron. Anyway, actually, that'll equal Q delta V. I was thinking along the next step, V final, if I multiply by 2 here, I'll have 2 times the absolute value of Q delta V divided by M is V final squared. But if I take the square root of that, I'll get the speed of this thing. And now I can just plug in numbers here. 1.60 times 10 to the minus 19th coulombs times 59 joules per coulomb. A joule is a tremendous amount of energy for an electron to have, but I don't think we're going to get there on this problem. And the mass of an electron, which you may not have memorized, but it's handy. You can get it lots of different places. Okay, so coulombs times joules per coulomb give me joules. You may not remember this, but 1 joule is equal to 1 kilogram meter squared per second squared. And so I'll have 1 kilogram meters per meter squared per second squared underneath. The kilograms divide out. I have meters squared per second squared. And when I take the square root, I get meters per second. So all of that. And finally, all we have to do is plug this into the calculator and figure it out. But I'm just curious to see if this is something that we might have to use special relativity late in the quarter to get a correct expression for. We actually don't have that many significant figures here. 1 centimeter. So, okay, I would get about 5 × 10^6 meters per second to 1 significant figure. And so that's a little more than 1% the speed of light. So we can more or less get away with, especially to just 1 significant figure, we can get away with not worrying about special relativity. But that's something that we'll learn. Anyway, that was an example problem. And big ideas here. One big one, when you have a uniform electric field and you're moving along the line of that electric field, it's just going to equal the electric field strength times however far you move. And that's a handy thing. And then we use this conservation of energy or actually it in this expression, it kind of looked like that, but to figure out the thing. So we'll be using these ideas quite a bit in this unit. Okay. Some other problems for today are, well, just a bunch of them. Calculating electric potential for various distributions and then looking at results of some of those calculations. So the first one is we have 3-point charges, 8 microcoulombs, minus 3 microcoulombs, and 5 microcoulombs located on the corners of a triangle whose sides are each 9.0 centimeters long. Calculate the electric potential at the center of this triangle, and then later the electric potential energy of this arrangement. Well, there was a problem on last week's homework that had to do with an equilateral triangle, and the first task in that thing was to figure out, oh, you were given, let's see, 2 electrons at the corners, and you were supposed to figure out what could you put at the third corner to make the electric field at the center of this thing 0, if I remember right. Well, part of what you needed to do for this problem was figure out how far it was from one of the charges or any of the charges to the center of the triangle. And the center of an equilateral triangle, I'm just going to quickly sketch some stuff here. But if you take and draw from each one of the corners of the triangle to the opposite side, it bisects that side. And so let's see, if this side has a total length of A, then this little chunk is going to be 1/2 A. That may not be very legible, but I'll scribble it out. That much is 1/2 A. All of the angles in an equilateral triangle are 60 degree angles, but this thing bisects that 60 degrees, and so this is going to be 30 degrees. And so we've got a triangle here where we know the adjacent side, and we want to know the hypotenuse. Well, the adjacent side over the hypotenuse, the 1/2 A over, I'm going to call the distance to the center X, distance from a point to the center. So 1/2 A over X is the cosine of 30 degrees. And so X is going to equal A over 2 times the cosine of 30 degrees. And it seems to me the cosine of 30 degrees is the square root of 3 over 2. So we'll have that. But I'm just going to plug this into my calculator to figure out that distance X, how far it is from there. And the side length on these was 9.0 centimeters. So 9 divided by 2 times the cosine of 30. Oh, make sure I'm in degrees. Yes, I am. I've done some problems recently where I was in, oh, great, 3 times the square root of 3. Okay. Or 5.2 centimeters. That's a 5, believe it or not. Okay, so that's how far it is from the center. Now, for the electric potential at the center of the triangle, I'm going to have 3 different charges, each of which is 5.2 centimeters away. So this is one of those things where we calculate the electric potential. By the way, this definition of electric potential, I'll just call this D1 plus K sub E Q2 over D2 plus K sub E D3 over, whoops, Q3 over D3. But D1, D2, and D3 are all 5.2 centimeters. But this definition of potential assumes or takes the definition that if we're infinitely way far away from the charges, we have chosen that point to be, or infinity to be, where the electric potential is zero. So that's just something to keep in mind. Sometimes we'll use different definitions for that. But case of B over D is the same in all cases. So I just have case of B over D times the sum of the charges. So 8 minus 3 is 5 plus 5. We actually end up with 10 microcoulombs for the net charge, because Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 is 10 microcoulombs. Anyway, now we can just plug in numbers. Case of B is 8.99 times 10 to the ninth Newton meter squared per Coulomb squared, divided by that 5.2 centimeters that we figured out. Whoops. Times 10 to the minus 2 meters. Okay, and so we'd have Newton meters. Oh, and then I'm multiplying that by 10 times 10 to the minus 6 coulombs. So I'll end up with Newton meters per coulomb, which are joules per coulomb, which are volts. Yeah, I get a fair amount actually. We're not very far away from these somewhat large charges. I get 1. I can only keep 2 sig figs, so 1.7 times 10 to the sixth volts. And if you want to remind yourself, OLTS there, that's the unit that we happen to have. Then it says calculate the electric potential energy of this arrangement. Well, the electric potential energy of 2 point charges is, this would be U equals K, Q, K sub E, Q1, Q2 over R. That's what it happens to be. And I've actually got three such pairs, and so I have to take this and I have K sub B, Q1, Q3 over R, and I have K sub B, Q2, Q3 over R. And I don't care which one's 1, 2, or 3, as long as I keep them straight when I'm doing this. And again, I've got K sub E over R is the same for all of them. So I can factor that out and multiply these things together. I'll take this one times that. That'll be negative 24, let's see, times 10 to the minus 12th. A micro times a micro is 10 to the minus 12th. Be careful about that. Or maybe just write these out. How's that? 8.0 times 10 to the minus 6th coulombs times negative 3.0 times 10 to the minus 6th coulombs plus, I'm going to have to continue this on the next line. Then 8 times 5. 8.0 times 10 to the minus 6 coulombs times 5.0, 10 to the minus 6 coulombs. And let's see, plus, I've got this pair, I just need that pair. This would be negative 3.0 times 10 to the minus 6 coulombs. Whoops. Ran out of room again, times 5.0 times 10 to the minus 6 coulombs. And the 10 to the minus 6 coulombs times 10 to the minus 6 coulombs gives me 10 to the minus 12 coulombs squared every time. I've got negative 24 plus 40. That'll be 16 minus 15 is actually 1.0 times 10 to the minus 12th. So I'll have K sub E, 8.99 times, and you could multiply these out if you want to, but they're easy enough to do in your head. Anyway, 10 to the ninth Newton meter squared per Coulomb squared divided by R. Now, this time they're separated by the length of the sides, which is 9 centimeters. So 9.0 times 10 to the minus 2 meters. And then when I multiplied all those things out, negative 24 plus 40, 40 minus 24 is 16, minus 15 is 1. I have 1.0 times 10 to the minus 12th Coulomb squared. So when I multiply this out, unit wise, Newton meter squared per Coulomb squared, the Coulomb squared go away, and I'll have Newton meters squared over meters will just be Newton meters. That's joules. So energy wise, that's what I get. And it's not bad after that, I guess. And I only have two significant figures. I get 9.99 times 10 to the minus 2, which rounds to 10 times 10 to the minus 2, which rounds to, well, if I show it in two significant figures, it should be 1.0 times 10 to the minus 1, I think. Yeah. Or 0.10, I guess I could call it, joules. Don't really need to use scientific notation in that case. Okay, well, there was another one. We hadn't done one with calculating the electric potential of a group of charges like that. So that was probably good practice. And then the electric potential energy ends up looking different. Okay, here's one, calculating a potential difference, kind of. We have an electric field in a certain region of space given by E equals alpha x along I hat. And the potential at x equals 5 centimeters is 100 volts, and the potential at 95 centimeters is 500 volts, and use this information to find the value of alpha. Well, for this, I'm going to use that expression delta V, which in this case is going to be V final minus V initial, or V of 95 centimeters minus V of 5 centimeters will equal the negative of the integral of E dot. Let's see, I'm going to use dx here for my length integral in this case, because I'll be moving along the x-axis. Now, I happen to know the left side already. V of 95 centimeters is 500 volts. V of 5 centimeters is 100 volts. So I can say 500 volts minus 100 volts is going to be the negative of, well, let's see, dx is going to be dx in the I hat direction in this case. And E, we have an expression for alpha x along I hat. So E dot dx will equal this dotted with that. I hat dot I hat is 1. It's just going to be alpha x dx. So that's all that happens to be. Now, I've got a minus sign here. So we're going to figure out what's going on here. And how many? I've only got, well, not much in the way of significant figures on the distances here, but 5 centimeters and 95 centimeters. So 400 volts on the left side is going to equal the negative of that integral. Let's see. Well, I'll have alpha here. Integrate x dx and you get 1/2 x squared. So I'll have 1/2 alpha x squared evaluated at 95. Let's see. I think I may change that to meters. 0.95 meters and 0.05 meters. And have minus 1/2 alpha times. I'm just going to do that subtraction here. Remember, I have to square these here. So and I actually get 0.90. Or one significant figure is 0.9 meters squared is what I have on that. And I can solve for alpha. Alpha will equal 2, well, yeah, let's just do it. Alpha equals actually negative 2 times 400 volts divided by 0.90 meters squared. So this thing's going to have kind of weird units. I could simplify it a little more, or maybe get more fundamental thinking of this as a joule per coulomb. Oh, it could get worse. I think I'm just going to kind of leave it alone. Yeah. And I get about to one significant figure, I get about 900 minus 900 volts per meter squared. And the fact that this is negative tells me that the electric field points in the negative I hat direction, which makes sense. If you're going from 5 centimeters to 95 centimeters and the electric potential is increasing, you must be going opposite the electric field. The increase in electric potential is opposite the direction of the electric field. Another way of thinking of that is, let's suppose you have a point charge here and the electric field due to that, and it's a plus Q, so doesn't matter what the point charge happens to be, but let's assume Q is the magnitude of the charge. The electric field surrounding this thing in space points radially outward from it all the time. Well, if you make a map of the electric potential as a function of distance away from this particle, where this is the origin here, The electric potential looks like KQ over R. And so as R gets very small, the electric potential blows up. And okay. And if you could get to zero, it would actually be infinity. But what you're doing is moving against the electric field. You're going uphill in the electric field sense. That's like going uphill in gravity, and you increase your gravitational potential energy. That's what you're doing when you're going opposite the electric field. So in order for the electric potential to increase, going from 5 centimeters to 95 centimeters, we must have been going against the electric field. So that helps to keep those things in mind. Okay, two charged, this is a different sort of problem, but two charged spherical conductors are connected by a long conducting wire. A total charge of 20 microcoulombs is placed on this combination of two spheres. If one has a radius of 4 centimeters and the other has a radius of 6 centimeters, what is the electric field near the surface of each sphere? Well, we haven't done anything like this one yet. Once you put that charge onto those two conducted that are connected by the long conducting wire, this system will quickly reach electrostatic equilibrium. And something that happens in that case, the charges will get as far away from each other as they possibly can. Well, where that is some of the charge is going to go on to the smaller of the two spheres. Some of it's going to go on to the larger of the two spheres, and they'll put themselves on the surfaces of the spheres. That's the only way that they can spread out as much as they can because they don't like each other. This total charge of 20 microcoulombs is going to be made up of a whole bunch of electrons, and they want to get as far away from each other as they can because, oh, actually, if it's positive 20 coulombs, you would steal electrons and then you'll have positive ions. But at any rate, the charge will be distributed on the surfaces of the spheres, and it's an electrostatic situation. And here's something in that case. The field within a conductor in, I'm going to abbreviate electrostatic, ES, for electrostatic. Is zero. Okay, now here's something. Delta V is equal to the integral of E dot ds. Okay. If the electric field is zero, then delta V is zero throughout this conductor. All the points in a conductor in electrostatic equilibrium are at equal potential. Equipotential is something that you may have to get used to, but anyway, we've got this smaller sphere here. This is the one with R is equal to 4 centimeters, I think. Yeah. And then somewhere over here, we've got a larger sphere, and here the radius is equal to 6 centimeters, and they're connected by a wire. Okay. A wire isn't of zero thickness. It's got some kind of diameter to it, maybe really small compared to the diameter of these spheres, but it's still there. However, these two things have to be at the same potential. And so we'll have a Q sub 4 on this one and a Q sub 6 on this one. And those two are going to add up to the total charge we put on here, the 20 microcoulombs. And so we could maybe transfer this drawing to what we've got here and think of this. Okay, so here's the four, and it's got a charge of Q4 on it. Here's the six, it's got a charge of Q6 on it. And then they're connected by a wire that makes them at equal potential. Okay, well, what's the potential of a charged sphere? It's actually, a sphere is V equals K, however much charge is on it, divided by its radius. Well, what can we do with that? These two are at the same thing, so I can say that, and this is K sub E, I may drop that E for a little subscript for a while. I can say that KQ4 over R4 is going to equal KQ6 over R6. Or I can just say maybe Q4 over Q6 is going to equal R4 over R6, which is just 2/3. Or I can say that Q4 is going to be 2/3 the charge of Q6. Right? And I know that Q4 plus Q6 is 20 microcoulombs. So well, Q4 is 2/3 Q6, so 2/3 Q6. Q6 plus Q6, which is 3/3 Q6, is equal to 20 microcoulombs. And let's see, that'll be 5/3 Q6 is equal to that, or Q6 is going to equal 3/5 times 20 microcoulombs, which is 12. Okay, and then Q4 is 2/3 of that, so Q4 will equal 2/3 of 12. It's going to be 8 microcoulombs. So now I know how much charge is on each sphere. And oh, question A is, if one has a radius of 4 centimeters and the other has a radius of 6 centimeters, what's the electric field near the surface of each sphere? Well, we know about electric fields of spherical charge distributions. They look like this: KQ over R squared. Okay. So we can calculate that. We know the charge on each sphere, and we know the radius of each sphere. So the electric field of the 4 centimeter one will equal K, which is 8.99 times 10 to the ninth Newton meters squared per Coulomb squared. Okay, and the charge on the 4-cylinder one is 8 microcoulombs, so 8 times 10 to the minus 6 coulombs. May as well just call that 9 times 10 to the ninth on this one. We don't have very many significant figures. And I'm dividing by its radius, which is 4 times 10 to the minus 2 meters, and I have to square that. Can we do this in our heads? Probably not. Actually, we can, kind of, but I don't feel like it. Too much work. That'd be 16 times 10 to the minus 4 meters squared. 8 over 16 is 1 half. 1 half times that. Yeah, we could do it, but I better be careful. It's Monday. And remember to square the bottom. Then I get 4.5. Okay, quandary here. That's right in the middle. I'm going to say 4 and then put a 0.5 there just to tell me that it was that. Then I have times 10 to the 7th. Now, unit wise, I've got meters squared on the bottom. Those will divide with those meters squared. I've got coulombs over coulombs squared. I'll have newtons per coulomb, which is newtons per coulomb or volts per meter. Okay, so that's the electric field near that one. And then for the other one, let's see. I'll just plug in the numbers. And I'm going to change this to 9 times 10 to the 9th Newton meter squared per Coulomb squared. And 12 times 10 to the minus 6, which technically is 2 sig figs, but. And then 6 times 10 to the minus 2 meters squared. And whatever, oh, this would be E6. Okay, for it, I only get 3 times 10 to the 7th newtons per coulomb or volts per meter. So this one is a weaker electric field, even though it has more charge on it, but it's got a bigger diameter and that gets squared in the denominator. Now, the electric potential of each square, that's going to be just KQ over R. I already said it was going to be the same on each one. And that's because you can see, well, we solved for the charge, assuming it was the same potential on each one. And so these expressions have to be equal unless we made some kind of an algebra flub. But the charge on 4 is 2/3 of the charge on 6, but the radius on 4 is 2/3 of the radius of 6. And so those 2/3 will divide out. And I would get the potential on either sphere, I'll just do for the 6 one here, is 8.99 times 10 to the 9th. And I probably don't need those significant figures. Newton meters squared per Coulomb squared times 12 times 10 to the minus 6 coulombs divided by the radius of that thing, 6 times 10 to the minus 2 meters. And this will be easy to simplify down. It's 12 divided by 6 is 2 times that. Well, I'll get like 18 or 1.8 times something. This problem probably came out of a book that said, assume all units are 3 significant figures, but I've long since lost those. I don't even remember which book I took this out of. And while I was talking, I get 1.8 times 10 to the 6th, so. And this should be joules per coulomb. Let's see, this would be Newton meters per coulomb. That's a joule per coulomb, yes, which are volts. Now, it doesn't bother me to set delta V equal to some number of V, but if I've just got a plain old V there, I'll write out the word volts to remind myself. Okay, another one. Okay, here's one. Can a conducting sphere 10 centimeters in radius hold a charge of 4 microcoulombs in air without breakdown? And then it explains here the dielectric strength of air, the minimum field required to produce breakdown, or the maximum field before breakdown occurs, is 3 megavolts per meter. Okay, now that's an electric field strength. Well, the electric field of us at the surface of a sphere, charged sphere, is just K times however much charge is on it divided by the radius of that thing squared. So this is just asking us if we stuck 4 microcoulombs on it and had a radius of 0.10 centimeters or 0.10 meters, would we get breakdown? Well, let's plug in the numbers and see. Be 8.99 times 10 to the ninth Newton meters squared per Coulomb squared. We could probably almost do this in our heads, but yeah, we could actually. Times 4 times 10 to the minus 6 Coulombs. Oh, by the way, on that previous problem, both of these electric fields, the E4 and the E6, are more than 3 million newtons per coulomb or 3 million volts per meter. And so both of these would be strong enough to cause air to break down. So you're going to have to set this experiment up in a vacuum or something that doesn't have a breakdown strength as low as air's happen to be. But I haven't looked those up. Anyway, 10 centimeters is 0.1 meters, and we're going to be squaring that. So let's just see what it comes out as. Nine, 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the seventh. Oh, 10 to the 11. I don't know. It's going to be a close thing. We'll see. Nope. In this case, the electric field, if you round it, it's comes to 4 megavolts per meter or 3.6 times 10 to the sixth volts per meter. And that is 3.6 megavolts per meter. So you're going to get some sparking going on, which would be kind of fun. Okay, and then it asks, what's the maximum charge which can be placed on a sphere of radius 5 centimeters? Well, we can just take the electric field strength and set it equal to 3 times 10 to the 6 volts per meter and solve for Q. So E is going to equal 3.6 times 10 to the 6 volts per meter, and that'll equal KQ over R squared. R is 5 centimeters, so Q would equal, and actually, if you put this much charge on it, you'll probably get some slight discharge occurring, but where you may have some of the charge leaking off this sphere in the form of sparks. But anyway, let's just plug this. We'd have to take our 3.6 times 10 to the sixth volts per meter and multiply it by 5.0 times 10 to the minus 2 meters squared. And actually, they don't give us a 0.0, so 5 times 10 to the minus 2. And oh, it's not 3.6, it's just 3. That's the breakdown strength. 3.6 was what we found in that one. Okay, so 5 times 10 to the minus 2 squared. And what am I dividing by that? K, 9 times 10 to the ninth. And I'm just rounding it to one significant figure. Newton meters squared per Coulomb squared. Then is this going to work? That'll give me meters squared. It'll divide with those. Man, am I going to have to get all the way down to the. I'm going to figure out the units here. Volts per meter times meters squared over Newton meters squared per Coulomb squared. And a volt is a joule per Coulomb. So I have meters, and a joule is a. I should end up. Oh, okay. I think I can see this. A meter squared over a meter is just a meter. That'll divide with one of those meters, leaving me a Newton meter. So I'll have joules per Coulomb divided by joules per Coulomb squared. Joules go away, and I'll end up with Coulombs. Good. Always important to have the right units. Okay, so 3 times 10 to the sixth here times that. Divided by 9 times 10 to the ninth. Oh, and I forgot to square that last thing. So I'll multiply by another 5 times 10 to the minus 2. I better start this calculation over again. Okay, 3 times 10 to the sixth times 2 squared. Okay, I get 8.3 times 10 to the minus 7th Coulomb. So it'd be about to one significant figures, it'd be 0.8 microcoulombs. So not nearly as much as those microcoulombs that we've been talking about here for a bit, but to the right number of significant figures there. Okay. I think I can quickly sketch out this problem here. And this, I don't know. Yeah, the next two I'm going to have to. Actually, I think I'll stop here and save these for tomorrow. And they're kind of interesting problems. So we'll take a look at those. But today, the big idea today for an awful lot of it was, well, actually, the last few had to do with spheres, but this was one of the big ideas for a while. And if you have a uniform field, you'll just have E delta X is going to end up equaling the potential difference within that thing. And this may be off by sign, but as far as the magnitude of that, it'll just equal the magnitude of the electric field times whatever distance you travel in it, as long as you're traveling in the direction of the electric field, or opposite the direction of the electric field. There's a section in the book on what they call equipotentials, and an equipotential is a line along which you can move where the electric potential doesn't change. And if you have a point charge, this will be the last thing I give you today. Point charge sitting here, the electric field radially away from it in every direction is, well, it's just radially away from it, is what it is. However, you can draw equipotentials on this thing if you travel along a path where at all times you make sure you're traveling perpendicular to the electric field, because if that's the case, then E dot ds will always be zero. Ds will always be, remember, this is magnitude of this, cosine of the angle between them. and the cosine of 90 degrees is zero. So if you carefully travel, always crossing the electric field lines perpendicular to them, you'll actually around a point charge, it's just a circle. Now, I may not have drawn a very good circle, but heck, that's a really lousy circle. But that's also evidenced by the fact that for a point charge, the electric potential is this. So as long as you stay the same distance away from it, you can travel around and you'll always be traveling perpendicular to the electric field. So the electric field won't do any work on you. So that's something to keep in mind. And there are equipotential surfaces for other charge configurations as well. All right, we'll stop there and I'll end the recording.
Hey, for homework two,
Uh-huh.
the links are just text.